So my name is Mark Danielly. I'm the Alamance County Extension Director and Horticulture Agent. Welcome to Buster Sykes Farm. This is the first program we've had at the farm. So all of our development is new. There's a list on the table of all of our plant varieties. So the orchard is our first step in developing the farm. We'll also have 4-H activities out here. So a lot of this will be learning how to grow fruit trees. So pruning, training, that's what Dr. Parker's gonna talk about. We'll also collect data on our trees. We've got different rootstocks, different varieties, and we'll start looking at bloom time. So I got two varieties of plums out there that are blooming full bloom right now. Who thinks it's gonna frost between now and the middle of April?
Yeah.
We won't have time on those trees almost certainly. Mike may talk about that. I got one variety of peaches is blooming. That's not very good. Other varieties of peaches are starting to show some color, and Mike will talk about that. So the possibility of us having peaches and plums is probably not too good. Apples are not quite as far along, so we'll see. But that's kind of the information we're going to collect every year. So when somebody calls and says, I want to plant 400 plum trees, I may not recommend that, because we can say on February the 28th, 2018, these plum trees were in full bloom. March the 14th, they went to 22 degrees. There goes your peach crop. So we'll be collecting that kind of information going forward. See what will grow here, what won't grow here. We've got a lot of new and different things, and we'll just learn over the years how to grow things, what we can grow and what we can't grow. But in any case, so today we're talking about pruning, training. If the weather breaks, we'll go out to the orchard. We hope it does. But we had Dr. Mike Parker here from NC State. He's our state tree fruit specialist, and he'll talk to us about how trees grow and how we prune them. We've cut some branches already, but he can tell us about how things work. Mike?
Thank you, Mark. It is a privilege to be with you this morning. How you came to a pruning workshop? Why would you go to a pruning workshop on a rainy morning like this? I don't know. So again, that's what we want to talk about today. We'll talk about training and pruning, but how many of you came with a question other than training and pruning about fruit trees? Nobody else? No other questions? Well, we're pretty good then, I guess. You got a couple other questions?
How can I handle voles?
Oh, voles, we can talk about that. So, yes?
What is that white that's painted on the wood?
It's white latex paint.
And why?
There's several things. One is to prevent any type of herbicide injury. You notice there's a grass-free area underneath the strip. That's a white latex paint. It protects that. It's also to protect from winter injury. You ever seen trees split, the trunk split late winter, early spring?
Freeze and thaw.
What's that? It's freeze and thaw, that's right. And it usually occurs in the southwest side of the tree. So, because we know that the trunk is going to be the most cold-sensitive portion of the tree, if we can paint it with white latex paint, reflect the sunlight, we can minimize how much heat up we get of that trunk to minimize that the heat up. Because what happens if you get a dark bark like that on a bright sunny day, that bark heats up well above air temperature. The sun goes down, temperature drops, and that trunk area can split. So we use that. It's a white latex paint. Latex. You use oil-based, it'll kill the tree. So. And we can talk about some of this as we go through. But again, as Mark said, my name is Mike Parker. I'm the fruit and nut specialist at NC State. How many of you tell someone your job and they laugh at you? I have to tell you, it's my job, it's not my personality. So we won't discuss that either. But if it grows out of a tree and you eat it, I get the opportunity to work with it, work across the state. Doing this type of program. I also have research plots across the state. We do a lot of work with our apples outside of Asheville and Mills River. Do a lot of work with our peaches down in the Sand Hills region. We have a research station there. We do a lot of work with pecans on pecans. Okay, I'm in friendly company today. Pecans, they're not pecans. On the eastern part of the state, usually on the I-95 corridor over in east. But they can be grown in this area. A bit of background, just to maybe clarify some things. I was raised in Michigan. My parents have a fruit farm up there. We had about 40 acres of apples, a couple acres of cherries, a couple hundred peach trees, and it was all sold through roadside retail. So I went from there, went to Michigan State University. I started out in landscape architecture. One semester, realized, no. That's not where I need to be. I spent 4 years in high school working through drawing and architectural things. I started out in landscape architecture because I wanted to be outside. one semester, and I started over to ag engineering, and I got halfway through my degree in ag engineering. You realize farming, it's not a job, it's a lifestyle. It really is. So I picked up and added horticulture as my second major. And I was getting ready to finish my degree there, and a professor came up and said, Mike, you ever thought about getting your master's degree? And I says, no. If you can't learn it in 4 years, you don't really need to know it. He says, I'll send you to Florida for 2 winters to work on citrus. 2 winters, all expense paid trip to Florida. That's a pretty good deal as far as I'm concerned.
For Michigan.
For Michigan, yeah. I went home at Christmas this past year for 7 days at my parents' and in-laws' place. The high temperature was 10 degrees. It was 5 and 10 below every night. This is actual. So again, yeah, okay, if you're going to pay for my education, you'll send me to Florida for 2 winters. I'll work on my master's degree. So I did a lot of work on post-harvest handling of citrus, a lot of work with apples, a lot of work with tomatoes as well. So I finished my master's degree, and I was ready to go work in a job in Florida. And a professor called, Mike, you ever thought about a PhD? And I said, no. No need for that. And he says, well, I'll cover all your expenses. So in a weak moment, I said yes, and so I got my PhD in orchard management, physiology, and production. The similar things that we're doing up there. So I've been here ever since working with apple growers, peach growers, pecan growers, extension service, and also people that have just one or two trees. Now, how many of you have more than 5 trees? Okay, a few of you. How many have more than 100 trees? Okay, a few. So again, you'll hear as we go through, you say, I talk about a lot of my work with commercial research, but I don't see a difference between someone plants one tree or if they plant 100 acres. When you plant a fruit tree, why do you plant a fruit tree? To fruit, for goodness sake. So again, if you don't get fruit off a tree, I call it firewood. So I have no problems using my chainsaw for that. So again, when people come to a program, that's what I want to make sure they understand is when you put a fruit tree in, we take that seriously. Now, you've got some publications, small-scale orchard production in North Carolina, and that's, and again, that I call small scales something less than, you know, or larger than one tree. So we've got that. We also have a publication. How many of you use the web? Okay. If you want to use the web, there's a training in pruning fruit trees. It's another publication that's available. I would encourage you, if you use the web, my name is Mike Parker. Just go into a web browser, type in Mike Parker NCSU. It'll bring up my web page. You get to my ugly picture. At that point, right in the right-hand side, click on Comprehensive Resources. It has a copy of all the publications that we have. We probably have 30 different videos talking about different aspects of peach, pecan, apple production. So again, I'm one of those people I need to see. Show them. I'm not from Missouri, but a video, a lot of times, I hate recording videos. Like we're doing today, because I can't change my mind and say, no, I didn't say that. Oh, don't do that, do they? I don't recall, Senator, and I don't use that. So again, you can look there and you can see all these resources available for you. Make sense? Because I'm sure you'll remember everything we talked about today. But again, we want to talk about training and pruning fruit trees. How many of you just came to a pruning workshop? Yeah, your hands go up there. But because we talk about training and pruning, there are two different practices, but again, as a kid, my dad and I, we would go to Michigan State, had their pruning workshops, and we would go, and we'd go to the orchard, this guy from the state college, he'd jump up there and prune a fruit tree, yeah, looks good. He'd go to another one, he'd jump up and he'd prune that tree, looks good. We'd go home and look at our trees. Where do you start? How many of you are so concerned about using a pair of these that you're going to kill your tree? Hands go up across the back. Yeah, I can guarantee for 99% of the public across North Carolina, they do more damage by not pruning enough than by over pruning. And so what I would like to do is, the trees that we look at many times are different, so I'd like to talk about the concepts of training pruning. So when you go and look at your fruit trees, you'll feel a little better about going in and pruning them. But again, we have to start our trees out right. So how many of you are going to plant trees? Okay, give a few hands. So again, what we're talking about is how you train your trees, how you prune your trees, going from very young to very old. Does that sound reasonable? Again, a couple ground rules. There's no such thing as a stupid question. If you have a question as we're going through that you want to address, throw up your hand. In fact, I may say things that are wrong. I may say, it's exactly right. The sky is green, the grass is blue. Carolina is a great university. If no one called that. Oops. I forgot we're recording this. And again, I have to warn you up front. This is not a politically correct presentation. But if, again, if people don't call me on things that I say wrong or you don't understand, we're in trouble, because that's where learning starts. When we have questions, that's where learning starts. And so that's what I'd like to do today. Again, it's still raining out, so we'll talk until the rain stops or our time runs out. But training is directing the growth of the tree into a desired shape or form. We don't put trees in time out. However, we do come in and use a lot of clothespins. Anybody here have clothespins in their pocket? I'm grabbing my coat here. What kind of guys carry around clothespins in their pocket? So we use a lot of clothespins for training and getting proper wide crotch angles. We use a lot of toothpicks to come in and spread branches out. We come in and use limb spreaders. I can show you some things that we use here. You can buy limb spreaders. These are aluminum ones. You can buy them by 1,000. You get them for 33 cents a piece. How many of you will order 1,000 of these? Probably won't order those. So how about if we give you another option? I did this program yesterday. Someone may have borrowed it. They did not. How about taking a piece of wood, 3/4 inch wood, drive a finishing nail in each end, cut it off at an angle. At that point in time, you've got a spreader. It's a whole lot cheaper than 33 cents a piece. And you make these in any different size that you want, 6, 12, 18, 24 inches. And that's to spread branches out. So that's what we talk about training. Now, again, if we start talking about training and pruning, how many of you have Bradford pear trees? How many of you have had Bradford pear trees? A lot of hands go up there. What happened to your Bradford pear tree? It broke. If we would use these training techniques, we could grow a Bradford pear tree. The problem is these wide crotch angles. When we pull these...
exactly what happens to a Bradford.
Yeah, that's right. Again, we look at those wide crotch angles, that's what happens. We see those wide crotch angles, and they are going to be a split. Now, if I look at a branch that comes out here, I can't pull that branch off because they're wide crotch angles. So if I'm going to be growing a fruit tree, I'm going to be starting getting those wide crotch angles from the day that they're planted. So I can't overemphasize that enough. Pruning is a removal of the tree that's used to maintain or correct tree growth. Now, how many of you came with questions about fertilization today? Oh, okay, I was going to say, a couple hands. Why would you come to a pruning workshop where you take growth off the tree and then how do you put more growth back on that tree? That's sort of a wasteful process, isn't it? However, it's necessary. So we will prune. We want to minimize how much pruning we do and maximize the training, putting the growth into a form that we can use and which we can put fruit. Need to talk a little bit about pruning equipment. Buy a nice set of hand pruners. These here are about $71. Pikas, again, this is not a recommendation. But now, again, if you can have something for 5 years, do you mind putting money into it? How about if you had it for 10 years? How about if you had it for 25 years? When I first came to North Carolina, I had an apple grower. He says, Mike, you need a pair of these pruners. I says, nah, that's too expensive. He gave me a pair. He says, I understand you're a state employee. Cut me slack. So he gave me a pair, and that's what I use now. Again, but you'll look at them, they're bypass pruners. Now, there are other good pruners out there. Mark, what kind of hand pruners do you use?
Felco.
How many of you have Felco pruners? Anybody?
Yeah, I got a pair right here if you want.
Got a pair in your pocket, that's good. How about red handle pruners? Very good pruners as well. And what separates the good from the bad is the quality of steel they're made out of. If you go into a store and they have red handles and they've been stamped out of sheet metal, that's a piece of junk, and I use that term literally, it is. It's the steel that they're made out of, that they hold an edge. This pair of pruners spent the winter sitting in a grower's orchard. They fell out of my truck. He found it the next spring in his mowing, he borrowed to me. Hit him with WD-40. Hit the blade with the file, and they're good to go. So again, the blades, the springs, they're all replaceable. So buy a good set of pruners. The other thing you need to buy is a good set of loppers. And these here, again, the ones I use here, they're felt. These are a Hickok, made in the United States. But you'll notice they're made out of forged steel. How hard do you think this steel is? You ain't gonna break this steel. You wear out a file trying to sharpen it because the steel is so hard. So again, this is the aluminum handles, 32 inch. I can do most of my pruning from the ground with a set like this. It's going to set you back about $50 for these. These are relatively new. I've only had these for 15 years. So, but again, you'll notice the theme is we spend money on pruning equipment, but we keep it. We buy good equipment. And then the last thing we need to have is a pruning saw. buy a good pruning saw. What's the difference between a pruning saw and a woodworking saw? A blade somewhat, these have sharp, these are, yeah, they're razor sharp teeth. On a wood saw, you, when you work in the shop, what does it cut? The push stroke or the pull stroke? It's only on the push stroke when we use a wood saw. However, on a pruning saw, it's on the push and the pull stroke, which doubles the efficiency of your action. So these are, this is a silky, it's got 11 inch folding blade. Make sure that they lock into place. If my hand goes in my pocket like this and it doesn't come out, be guaranteed that I ran the saw across the back of my hand. Operator error, if you will. So again, buy a good set of pruning saw that locks into place. You might as well know back there, Mark and I, we were preparing saws. This is silky, they make a wide range of them. Mark, have you ever seen a saw as good as a silky?
Yeah.
So?
I got three of them.
He's got three of them. The stuff
Japanese,
I use for, what's that now?
Japanese.
It is Japanese.
Also.
Everything else, you know, the hip-hop, but again, these are the Japanese saw, the best ones that's made. Because the Japanese start out with the trim saws, you know, some of their inlay work, that's how they start out with these, they're cutting underneath doors, that's how they started and they moved it into pruning saws. So a nice pruning saw. Now, how many of you have more than two or three trees? Okay, well, I'm gonna use something here. And sometimes I was getting a bit concerned I was gonna bring these out, and as soon as I bring them out, people say that doesn't include me. But I've got a pair of pruners like this here. And again, if you have to do much pruning, you might wanna consider something along these lines. Again, if you come out and prune a branch like this, how easy is it to prune it?
Oh, yeah.
So, okay. Now these run, they're $800. However, they figure they'll last 10 years. I can use these for, I basically make 12,000 cuts a day. Run 10 hours a day. So again, you put it on, you wear this, it's a vest, and the battery sits across your back. So again, if you start, oh, they weigh about 2.5 pounds. Feel that.
I won't use it. I'm back away.
I told Mark his saw. I says, Mark, don't put your saw down, because that may go back to Raleigh. So again, we start looking at these. This is what we're starting to go into commercially, because of repetitive motions, because of shoulders, basically elbows, wrists. That's right.
Yes.
Carpal tunnel. That's exactly right. So again, the first pair I saw in North Carolina was 10 years ago because the guy had carpal tunnel surgery. He couldn't use his hand pruners anymore because it was hurting his thumb so much. So again, buy good pruning equipment. And that's used for, you know, for all, you can use it for anything. Now again, we can also talk about if you're gonna be going between plants, I don't think we have to worry about disinfecting pruning equipment, but how many of you disinfect equipment? And what do you use for disinfecting? Okay, Clorox. This 30% Clorox in water. I spray my equipment, I look at them the next morning, guess what? They're rusted. It eats up stuff. Alcohol. We can use isopropyl alcohol. Our employees were very happy when we were using this. It disappeared very quickly. It evaporated. So alcohol can be used. However, the number one pesticide sold in the United States is what? Lysol. I wasn't ignoring you. Lysol, it's a, and again, if you look at the label, it's an antibacterial. It kills bacteria. So again, I use Lysol, 30% Lysol in a spray bottle, and I spray my equipment. It doesn't you know, wreck the equipment, doesn't stain my clothes, I smell pine fresh. So again, it's a good product to use if you need to disinfect your pruning shears. You come out and you spray them, and you can move on. So,
you,
it does not rust your equipment. No, it does not. Where bleach does. You just bleach it again. I got $300 in my clothes, $300 in my pruning equipment. And you basically Lysol, it eats up clothes, or the Clorox eats up clothes very quickly. So with all that said, now how many of you feel better about pruning a fruit tree now? Oh, Mark. We'll try again. So again, why do we train and prune? Why did you all come out in a rainy morning? We want to control tree size and shape. How about developing a strong tree structure to support the fruit crop? Again, this is a picture here. I'm not sure you can see it. Have you ever seen a peach tree split right in the center? Right down the middle. This one here was taken one of our largest commercial growers. Mark, you may have been with me. we went over to this grower and he called me. We were down Sand Hills working. He said, Mike, I want you to come over and take a look at my trees. We gave him a variety that NC State had developed. It was a numbered selection at the time. And he planted them out. He says, Mike, I didn't think a whole lot about this variety. However, he says, I have to change my mind. Those trees set with such a heavy fruit crop that they split all of his trees. So again, we want to make sure that we prune and train our trees so they can tolerate that crop load. How about removing the dead, damaged, and diseased wood? You know, that goes without saying. Excuse me. How many of you have pear or apple trees? How many of you have heard about fire blight? Fire blight is a bacterial pathogen. It starts in the tips of branches or blossoms. When the tips of the branches turn over like a shepherd's crook, the leaves stay on and it moves back. That's that bacterium moving within the plant. You'll see it on Bradford pears some in a bad year. When you see that last visible dead leaf, we know that that bacterium is 12 to 15 inches back into what appears to be healthy tissue. So if I cut into that tissue with my pruning shears, what have I just done? I've contaminated them, and every other cut that I make, I spread the disease. So during the growing season, that's why we disinfect. However, we know that that bacterium will move within that plant, and it'll set a canker. You see the sort of the discoloration here as it moves down? In the fall, it stops here. In the winter, there's a canker. We can cut just beneath that canker and get the live tissue. And we don't spread the disease. Now, you probably have learned by now that I'm quite an academic. I get most of my educational information from the comic strip on Sunday. And one of the ones I look at is Hagar the Horrible. You know the Viking. And it shows Hagar the Horrible in a tire swing. As a little kid, I don't know where a Viking got a tire. He was swinging. The next one over it says, 40 years later, he's looking up at the tire swing. Is that true? Yeah. Trees don't grow out of the ground? They grow from the tip up, don't they? And what part of that plant is growing? Top? How about the branches? Do they grow in diameter? There's only one part of this plant that's growing. It's what we call the cambial layer. Anybody ever hit a tree with a lawnmower during the summer? guilty. So you hit that bark, and it slips off, doesn't it? The bark slips very easily, and that's at the growing point. So one of the things you can look at is if you cut into a tree limb, it's green. And that green layer just underneath the bark is what we call the cambial layer. That's the only part that's growing. So if I cut into this, if I cut into that canker, can you see where that canker's at? Can you see where it goes from green to brown? So again, and that's where when we come in and cut that out, we need to make sure we're out of that dead tissue, cutting into green wood, because that's the only part that's growing. So again, that's the dead damage. That growth needs to come out during the growing or during the dormant season. I guess I probably should talk about there's a difference between summer pruning and dormant pruning. How many of you say you never prune during the summer? If we look at the old literature, you never prune. We do an awful lot of pruning during the summer. When I'm pruning during the dormant season, I'm using these. If I'm pruning during the summer, I'm going to be coming in and using something like these, or better yet, these. So again, and that's removing dead, damaged, and diseased wood at both during the growing season and during the dormant season. How about increasing light penetration? Anybody have an old apple tree? Uh-oh. those older trees like that, where's all the fruit at? It's in the top. Why is that? It's where the light's at. So we talk about light penetration, and we'll talk about light for several things. The primary thing is we know the flower buds that are going to be coming out in 3 or 4 weeks, Mark, maybe not. Those flower blossoms out there that are out now, those flower buds were formed last summer. Last June and July is when those flower buds were formed. In order for those flowers to form, it's a biochemical reaction. That leaf needs at least 30% full sunlight. Otherwise, it's not going to initiate a flower. It'll just have a leaf there. So the more light that we get back in, we can keep fruit back towards the center of the tree. We also know, well, Parker, 30%, I can live with that. I'll plant my tree in 50% shade. What happens when you move basically 18 inches inside a tree's canopy? What happens to light levels? They're going to drop. How much do you think light levels would drop by? About half, maybe, depending on the tree. So again, we move 18 inches inside a canopy. That's why these apple trees, the fruit's only at the top. So another, we look at light penetration, fruit quality. We need at least 75% full sunlight for optimal fruit quality. How many of you like high quality fruit? You don't buy it from Washington then, do you? So we'll come back and talk about that. So we increase light penetration. We also want to increase spray penetration, air movement. Now, what's the definition of organic? You're getting more than we normally do in this presentation because it doesn't look so promising outside, does it, Mark?
Not right now.
Not right now. So again, what's the definition of organic?
Living.
Living?
No pesticides.
What's that?
No pesticides.
No pesticides.
Limited pesticides.
Some carbon dioxide nitrogen, and you get some, actually, we need to take a little more. If we look at 15 years ago, organic was whatever you wanted to call it. Mark and I may have different definitions of what organic is. Now it's a USDA grade standard. It means you can put nothing on that tree that is synthetic. Everything that goes on that tree has to be natural. So we know that natural things are very safe for us, don't we? Arsenic? Nicotine? Maybe I'll have to go back to the drawing board. So if we look at it, again, I work with conventional growers. I work with organic growers. I really don't care. Quite frankly, I will help them understand it. We need to understand that organic trees are not sprayed or no pesticide. Trees that are not sprayed, I call neglect. So again, because if we look at the literature, you're exactly right. People say there's no pesticides or they haven't been sprayed. And nothing could be further from the truth. Our organic apple growers have to spray probably 40% more than our conventional ones do. So again, I don't really care if you're conventional or organic. You have to have spray penetration into the interior of that tree. We also want to have air movement. The more air that we get in there, the more sunlight we can get in there. Hopefully we can reduce the disease and insect pressure within that tree. What's worse than finding a worm in your apple? Finding half a worm. Why is that? It's 100% protein. It's apple flavor. My dad used to say if we put worms in our cider, we have to charge you more. Protein is $1.99 a pound, and a gallon of cider is 10 pounds, and we sell it for $5. So again, we go back to how many of you are willing to accept substandard fruit? How many of you have fruits and vegetables in your garden are willing to cut out a spot? I think we're all willing to do that. We all do that. How many of you are willing to buy something from a grocery store that you have to cut out spots? Come on, there's a double standard here, folks, isn't there? So again, we have to understand what we're trying to do. And if we're growing fruit for ourselves, we can tolerate a little more damage. But if we're trying to sell fruit that we would sell at a roadside market, a roadside stand, quality is going to be a key. And we'll talk about how our consumers define that. So again, we talked about why we're doing it. What are the benefits? Optimal tree structure to give higher long-term yields. Again, that long-term is going to be key. When you plant a fruit tree, it's a long-term. If we're looking at peach trees, they're probably about a 20-year tree. If we look at apples, they'll be 25-plus years going up. So again, we have to make sure we can't get greedy for this year. We need to be looking down the road 5-10 years from now. We talked about increased fruit quality. Now, I've talked a bit about that. Now, when you talk about a flavor, when you say that's a good fruit, what are flavor characteristics you're looking for?
Sweetness,
that's right. And what makes the fruit sweet?
Sugar.
Sugar, that's good. Oh, very hard, was it? Not photosynthetic pathways developing sugar. What makes a sour apple sour?
Not sugar.
No sugar, and that's exactly wrong. So is we I wasn't setting you up for that one, was I? Most people say you get diabetics. My wife's a dietitian. And you get diabetics, I can't eat sweet fruit because I can't have the sugar. So they can eat some of the sour fruit. No. So do you know that a lemon has about the same amount of sugar as a peach does? What does that tell you maybe where that tartness is coming from? It's coming from citric acid. So if we would look, again, we don't have citric acid in fruit. You're doing good here. So we don't have citric acid in apples or peaches, but we do have malic acid. And we look at, when we get that balance between the sugars and the acids, that's when we get that high quality fruit. So again, it's that ratio that we're after in both the citric acid or the malic acid and the solids that make up the flavor are formed through the photosynthetic pathway. So we will get higher quality fruit by getting light penetration. How about color? Is color an indicator of fruit quality? Yes? How many of you have had those beautiful red delicious in the state of Washington? Oh, hey, you change your mind?
Yeah,
it's the best tasting cardboard there is. Again, I'm not sorry. So again, we look at the problem in North Carolina getting color in fruit You can see here, this is a piece that we had a leaf over that. Pulled the leaf away, you can see the color here. The problem is with getting color in North Carolina, color is brought upon by two things: bright sunny days and cool nights. So when we're maturing fruit in August, we get bright sunny days?
Yes.
We get those 65 degree nights?
No.
So we're not going to get that vibrant color. So again, it's not an indicator of quality unless you expect it. If you plant a double red delicious apple, what kind of apple do you want to have? You want to have a double red delicious, don't you? You want something with color there. Color is not an indicator of quality. However, we know that 85% of produce is bought based upon visual appearance. Y'all wouldn't buy fruit that has small imperfections you have to cut out. Some people will not buy fruit unless it's red. Redder is better used to be the mantra. The last thing we look at quality, we have to reduce disease pressure. And then the final thing that we look at, the quality and benefits, it looks good. Do you think the guy picking 100 acres of fruit cares what that orchard looks like as long as it's paying money, as long as it's paying the bills and generating profit? Do you think he cares what it looks like? Do farmers take pride in what their fields look like?
Yes.
You better believe they do. We'll go out to Hendersonville, the western part of the state, and we'll go to the Waffle House on Beer Wallow Road in the morning. The discussion, you ever see so-and-so's orchard? What is he doing? I have no idea. He must have lost his lease. It has to look good. Doesn't matter if it's one tree or 100 acres. It's got to look good. So again, that's another benefit that we look at. Now, how many of you feel better about pruning fruit trees? But we're not doing so well. So again, if we talk about fruit trees, how do those trees look? I'm going to talk about two different training systems. One will be a central leader tree. Central leader tree is characterized by a strong trunk going up through the middle of the tree with lateral branches coming off from it. This is usually going to be what we train apples, pears, pecans to. Now, when we come up, what's the optimal height on which to start branches?
30 inches.
30 inches? Why 30 inches?
Oh, damage from equipment. Sorry.
Damage from equipment underneath them?
Yeah.
Any other ideas of height to start branches? My tree, my yard, I've got I like 28 inches. 28 inches is what I say of, you know, I can get my boom, you know, 30 inches, same thing. It's equipment, and that's knowing what that height is. Because there's no optimal or basically correct height to which to start branches. It's so, like you say, it's to get equipment underneath them. I usually start mine at 28 inches. I've got some trees in my yard. I've got all my branches start up about this high. Why do you think that is? Goodbye.
Bye.
Thanks for coming. Hey, I wish my kids were that well behaved on the inside. I'll tell you. You see them very good. So again, all my branches are this high now. I started them out knee high, but they're up this high now. Dear. What we call browse line. So again, we look at that height. It's when you get equipment underneath them. So many times for smaller trees, the optimal height is to sit yourself in your lawnmower. Where does it hit you on the head?
Can I ask you something? Does the rootstock choice, particularly with apples, make any difference with that too? Would that help determine that, or is it just what you want to do is get them up there?
That's a real good question. Does the rootstock dictate that? No, it doesn't. We'll talk about that in a minute. We talk about dwarfing rootstocks. We're going to have shorter trees. So yeah, the closer you start your branch to the ground, the more your productive area will be. Because if I'm growing a 10-foot tall tree and I start my branches at 2 foot, or if I start them at 48 inches, I'm losing 2 foot of, 48 foot. So I'm losing 2 foot of production. So that height doesn't really matter with the rootstock. Now if we're talking about pecans, and we know on pecans at maturity, our first branch on pecans is gonna be 6 foot off the ground. If I'm trying to mow around a pecan with a tractor, I'm trying to put a shaker in, we know that first branch is going to be 6 foot off the ground. When we start talking about apples, no, we want those as close to the ground as possible, allowing for maintenance underneath the tree. Because one of the major expenses with fruit is what?
Waste.
But when managing that tree, what do you think where we put the most money?
Picking.
Picking is followed closely by what?
Chemicals.
Chemicals or pruning?
Light.
Same way with chemicals.
Light.
Pruning, you know, labor for pruning and picking or chemicals, the lower I have that to the ground, I can reduce the cost for all three of us. Because if I can keep people off ladders, I'm much better off. So again, this would be a semi-dwarf apple tree. larger tree, 15, 18 foot tall tree. So we'll start our first set of branches. And they're what we call this a whorl of branches. North, south, east, and west. It's pretty hard to show a four-dimensional tree on a basically a two-dimensional board here. So again, we would have a branch coming out, we'd have a branch going back towards the wall. And then we'll leave an area of about 18 to 24 inches without branches, allowing light. We call that a light slot, allowing light to come in. Then we'll have another set of branches come in. Then we will leave another area of 18 inches, allowing light penetration. Then we'll do that up to the ultimate height of the tree, at which point we will cut the tree out to an outward growing branch. We do that when these branches are at least 2 years old. So again, that's what a tree would look like. Anything about that shape that may be a little different? You know, any other characteristic of that tree shape that may not be all that natural?
The cone.
The cone shape, that's right. We get that conical shape there. Branches at the top must be shorter than those at the bottom. You ever see trees that umbrella out at the top? What do you think that does to the light penetration within that tree? It kills it. So again, we want to make sure those branches are like that. I made a statement just a couple minutes ago. How many of you want to grow your fruit naturally? Laughing over here. What's that now?
Grow naturally.
Yeah, growing.
It's growing. It's natural.
Well, it's growing naturally, but some people say, well, I don't want to intervene. If you don't want to intervene, you want to grow your fruit naturally. You won't train. You won't prune. You'll allow branches to grow, and you won't pick fruit. When we grow fruit, we grow vegetables. It's not a natural environment. Again, if I had a natural environment in my yard, I've got deer. They come in. They work in my trees, 4.5 foot down. Anything that's growing on the ground, they munch on. I mean, I don't even try to grow vegetables. My hostas have a hard enough time with the deer munching on them. Again, if we're going to try to grow fruit, vegetables, we're going to have to do something to contain the natural influence. That's I'm paid for. Yes, sir?
Spray deer repellent?
Yeah, you can spray deer repellent. And deer are fairly smart, and deer repellents do work. Some of them do work. But again, if you're spraying on a fruit tree, make sure it's labeled to be sprayed on a fruit tree. There are some things you put in there that may not be used on a fruit tree. So again, if your deer repellents work, I'm going there now. The label's the law. They work. What happens if you get a rain? It washes away out. Because most of the deer repellents, there's something. A lot of times there'll be rotten eggs involved in that. There may be garlic. We've got some you put in a truck and you don't ride in the front of the truck when you've got that jug there because it's downright nasty stuff. So again, if we're looking at deer, you could use deer repellents. As long as we're talking about deer, the best way to control deer is high velocity lead poisoning. It's effective. Legally. That's the way to do it. We can discourage them. We also use bars, hotel bars of soap. You take the smelliest stuff you can get, leave the wrapper on, drill a hole through it, put a piece of string, hang them on the edges of branches. Again, do not put it in the tree because as that soap breaks down, what is one of the main ingredients in soap? Lye or fats. They run down that trunk. Rabbits love to eat on the fats. So they'll come up and grow the tree. So you can put them on the edge there. You can cut dryer sheets into inch ribbons, put them on the tree with a clothespin. There are things you can do to discourage them, but deer are smart and they will come back. You're going to have to rotate anything you do over a period of time. You get 3 weeks out of one protective measure, you're good.
Squirrels?
My velocity lead poisoning is the same way. I don't know, quite frankly, how to do that in a home setting.
I tell you what, I have deer that gets on their hind legs just like a goat. It's fruit. Yeah. But squirrels is a bigger problem for me than any.
Well, we look at our
kill.
Yeah, again, we can use some high velocity selective thinning. We can also come in and we use traps. The traps that we use are not catch and release traps. How many of you have ever seen people that use a live trap and relocate squirrels?
Yeah.
Again, those squirrels probably beat you home. They do. The other thing is it's illegal. Basically, catching and releasing, relocating wildlife requires a license for that. So, but I wish I had an answer for you. I don't.
They destroyed my car.
Yeah. Some people, you know,
and don't wait for it to ride again.
No, that's right. That's a problem. And again, lots of crops will find you'll get birds and birds and crows will do the same thing. We have a bird specialist here.
I have birds.
You know, crows are our problem. This picture. Crows are a problem as well.
I think what works pretty good for crows is take you know the first type of hose pipe that they came out, the soaker pipes.
Yes, yep.
Just take pick those things, the old ones,
yep.
They don't last 7 years. Come up and lay them all through the trees like a snake.
Oh, like a snake?
And that works for perfect.
Okay, I haven't heard that before.
That works for perfect.
Okay.
Same way in your garden.
Yeah.
Same way
in your garden. I haven't heard that.
I just take, you know, with corn, you know, yep. How they work on corn. Just take those things and cut them up in about 4 or 5 foot lengths and put them out through your garden.
That makes sense.
It works.
Let's try that.
Part has for me.
Yeah.
And I've been using it for several years and it continues.
Okay. Our pecan growers, they love to hang crows in the tree. They get a crow and they hang them by their feet. We'll move on. But again, this is what we look at. This is what we're looking at for a central leader tree. However, I don't know why anybody nowadays would plant a full-size apple tree. I think looking at dwarfing rootstocks, and Mark, you're using some, you've got dwarfing rootstocks as well as MM111 up there. Planting the larger trees, having to wait 5 to 7 years for fruit, having to climb up and down to train and prune could be an issue. We can look at dwarf trees. Dwarf trees we have, again, this would be a traditional tree. We have a central leader, but if we go with these high density trees, they're still gonna have a central leader, but you'll notice the branches are gonna be very close together. You'll also notice they're all going to have a stake beside them. We're going to support those trees. Those stakes aren't there for moral support. They're there for fiscal support. We, on a dwarfing rootstock, we expect to have fruit in those trees within the third year. So again, if we were looking at a full-size apple tree, a 20 by 20 spacing, Mark, are they 18s or 20s up here?
20.
20 foot. So if we assume 20 by 20 for a full-size apple tree, 400 square foot, why would I put that in my yard when I can come in and put 6 or 7 dwarf trees in that same footprint? I can have fruit in the third year. If I get fire blight in that tree, for goodness sakes, I can cut that tree out. And I still have 75-80% of my production. So again, I would be looking at apples, we start looking at higher density systems. But again, the only way that will happen is if we use a dwarfing rootstock. Then we'll move on to the last system we can talk about, an open center. This is usually what we'll prune peaches to, maybe plums. Again, we come up approximately knee height, and then we'll take branches out at about a 60 degree angle. 3 to 5 branches coming out. If we look from the top, this is what's going to look like. We have our trunk here. We have 4 branches coming out. And what we will do is we will cause those branches to fork. Again, we don't have a dwarfing rootstock for peaches yet. If you see someone selling you a dwarfing rootstock and peach, my mom always gave me what for if I told a half truth, and that's what they're selling. If something's reduced 10%, is it a dwarf? No, I don't think so. So again, this is what we want to have. Branches growing out at a 60-degree angle. The way we prune these trees is somewhat archaic because you'll notice we keep directing the growth outward at that 60-degree angle. If we allow them to go, they're gonna go straight upright. Sound reasonable? Well, the $500, it's starting to let up, Mark?
Yeah, it looks like it's not raining much.
Right now.
Okay, right now.
I'm talking about the buds on the trees.
Yeah. The $500 take home, how many of you feel better about pruning your fruit trees now? I'm giving you all I got. I'm sorry. Tell you what, when making a cut on a tree, what should be the primary determining factor where you make a cut? This is the $500 take home message. This should be worth your time coming out today. Outward growing bud. That can, yeah. And sometimes that helps because even though I cut to an out, if I make a branch to an outward growing bud, you have to realize that the 3 or 4 right beneath it, they want to grow up as well. So that outward cut, you know, historically we've done that. I don't think it's going to be all that beneficial when we make a heading branch. That, but you look at the literature, that's what they always say, don't they? You cut to an outward growing bud, but when you come in and cut a branch back to an outward growing bud, you're getting rid of the hormones that are producing that tip. And those top 3 or 4 buds are going to be very vigorous. You ever cut a branch and notice how they shoot upright?
Yeah.
You ever see these butchers that they go into these trees, these large trees, and they dehorn them?
Mm-hmm.
I won't talk about them right now. But what kind of growth do they get? One?
No.
Two?
It's a squirrel basket.
That's right. A witch's broom comes up. So if we look at that with fruit trees or cutting to outward growing bud, that really doesn't hold true in many situations. And the other, yes, sir?
How do you prune an Asian pear, Asian persimmon, he has such heavy fruit.
Yes, we will prune that just like a central leader tree. We won't do a whole lot of pruning on the Oriental persimmons because they're somewhat small. What you'll do is you'll thin fruit. When they start to fish pull your branches, the thing you have to do is thin the fruit earlier in the season.
Thank you.
Okay, now pruning, what should be the primary determining factor? You know, a lot of times I go to a pruning demonstration and people, Felco's in your pocket. But you know, a lot of times people have Felco's on their belt and they come out and as I'm talking in the field, they're going around cutting tips off branches all the way around that tree. You know, these guys from university, those who can do, those who can't teach. So I'm teaching and he's a, you know, the guy from university, I'll help him and he's cutting all the tips off my branches. Is that good? Why not?
You're breaking the dominance on the end of the branch and causing...
Yes, every place we're making a cut, we're causing a release. But you know what? I think maybe the primary determining factor where we make a cut is, how about where's the fruit forming? This is the take-home message. On a apple, if we were looking at an apple tree, the apples, the only place they're formed is going to be at the tips of shoots. These long shoots aren't going to have it. But our small shoots like this. You see that one right there? It's what we call, it's going to be a spur, grows less than an inch a year. See that fat bud in the end? That's a flower bud. This one here, it's not. But the only place apples will be formed on tips of branches. So somebody goes through their apple orchard and they cut the tips off branches like that. Do you think that happens? It happens all the time. And again, I was working with a guy yesterday. He grows peaches. Had a group like this, and he says, Mike told me 6 years ago that I shouldn't plant apple trees, and $3,000 later, he says, I have to agree with him. I can teach an apple grower to grow peaches. Trying to teach a peach grower to grow apples is terrible. Because on peaches, we do a lot of heading of branches. And so they prune their apple tree like a peach tree. They cut all the fruit off. I did a program down over in Whiteville, Little Washington area, or it was Beaufort, Little Washington area. Did a 3-hour program in the morning. We were going to do a 3-hour demonstration in the afternoon. And the gentleman came up to me after the morning and says, Mike, is it okay if we don't go to my orchard today? I said, it's okay. It's only half the program. Don't worry about it. I don't like surprises. I went and looked at that orchard the day before. This gentleman, it was a small orchard. Every tree in that apple orchard, every tree, every branch had been cut back. He says, I didn't know why I didn't have fruit until today. So every place he made a cut, you're all right. Every place he made a cut, he released apical dominance, had 3 or 4 shoots coming out. He also cut the fruit off. Then he'd come back and cut those 3 or 4 branches next year. He'd have 3 or 4. It's a multiplication process down the road. He didn't have fruit, and he won't have fruit. So if you're, and apples, if you're cutting the tips off branches, you're in trouble. However, on peaches, if we were looking at a peach like that, you see those large swellings on that? See the redwood? Again, those are all going to be peaches. If we would look at a branch like this here, how many peaches do you think are going to be in this branch? How many peaches do you think this branch can tolerate?
3.
6 to 8 inches or so between peaches. So again, if we would look at this, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. There's about 17 peaches on this here. So when we have this redwood coming out in a peach tree, we will allow that to come out. We will cut it back by about a third. You look at the tips here. There's no flowers on the tips. There's very few flowers at the tips of these branches. And we know that when we grow peaches, the number one economic input into peaches when we have a full crop is going to be hand thinning. About $1,200 an acre to thin fruit. So when I'm dormant pruning, why don't I come in and cut the tip back like this? By cutting that there, I stiffen this branch. And then I allow this one here, I can have about 3 peaches. I can put one here, 6 inches, one there, and I can put a peach there. So in peaches, I will come in and I will head most of my redwood, these shoots like this, if they're growing out. If I have a branch growing out like this, you want to keep it out at a 60 degree angle. I'll come in and I cut and get rid of the things that are shading growth beneath there. And then I will cut out shaded, the things growing underneath. Does that look reasonable?
Are you going to cut that tip off that peach at the end?
I am. Where am I going to cut it out at?
Back at the next leader.
We never come in and make, usually on the young tree, we try to cut to a branch. So again, let's say it's growing out like this.
It's an old tree.
Let's go back and talk about this. Again, See how it's sort of a fan? We keep those shoots there. Then we'll cut those back by about a third, just to tip them back so that I stiffen up those branches, because these are fruiting wood. These, all this redwood, it's all fruiting wood. So again, pretend here. We have our scaffold branch growing out. Sometimes we will have, they'll be growing like this. See, is that a 60 degree angle here? Is that a 60 degree angle there? So what if I come in and cut this out, maintaining upward growth? I get rid of the upward growing branch and then cut out to an outward growing branch at a 60 degree angle. Now, as you notice, I don't come in and cut to a flat growing branch. I cut to an outward growing branch up at approximately a 60 degree angle. Make sense?
Mm-hmm. What's the easiest way, and I've been shown more than one time, and I just can't grasp it, between a flowering bud on an apple tree and a fruit bud? I just can't never get the hold of it.
Well, it's not all that hard. This time of the year, there's two things. One, first of all, this is my apple tree. There's only three potential places this branch could have an apple. Where are they?
Tips.
Only places tips. Only here, here, or here.
Yeah. It's in these situations.
That's right. Threw my example away. what you do is, at this time of the year, it's quite easy. You look at the tips, the buds here. We know, again, realizing it's only going to be in tips. It's only going to be on somewhat weak growing. See, this is all last year's growth last year. You see that bud there in the end? It's not really much of one, is it? How about looking at that bud right there? See how it's fat?
But see, on my trees, I have these all along.
Again, it's an older tree.
Yeah.
And again, that's good. Again, these branches that grow less than an inch a year, what we call spurs, those are the most fruitful wood you can have there.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, almost all of those, if your tree's healthy, almost all of those will have a flower bud in them too.
It came out and tried to show me one time the difference in the size.
It works on some cases. It's subtle difference. It's maybe the size, but it's also the shape. A flower bud would be more rounded or a dome. If you look at these here, they're pointed. So again, it's not something.
And a leaf bud would be a flatter.
That's a leaf. Every place, those are all leaf buds.
But I'm talking about in this situation, when it's got that little growth on it.
That's a leaf bud right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Actually, they're going to be more of a pointy shape. The trees up here, we can come back next year. Mark's trees, they don't have fruit on them this year, the apples, and they shouldn't. We plant a fruit tree. I don't want fruit left in that tree for at least 3 years from the time they're planted.
Would you advise taking those spurs off since they're not going to fruit anyway, or just
no.
Let them go natural?
No. Again, I'm going to use those spurs there.
Yeah.
Again, this came off a dwarf tree. I want fruit there next year. Also, what's that spur going to have on it this year? It's going to have leaves. Those leaves are going to produce fruit also, or carbohydrates all summer long. They're going to take them and send them to the root system in the fall of the year. It's going to help that tree next spring.
Going back to his question, the fact that bud is closer to the main leg of the trunk, would that make that bud better than one out on the end, or is that?
Now this one here?
Yeah.
Again, we start pruning these trees like that, there's two, my rule comes back. Is it shading anything, or is it being shaded? Is that going to shade anything?
No.
How about this one here, would that shade anything?
Yes.
If I have leaves from here to here?
Yes.
Yeah. So again, when I see small growth like that on the trunk or on branches, I leave all that small growth. Because it's not a problem. And anytime I can put leaves, I can prevent sun scald, sunburn on that branch. Now again, on a peach here, these blossoms coming out, I get this peach blossom coming out. How many peaches would be formed by a peach blossom?
One.
Is that any harder? This apple blossom coming out, how many apples would be formed in an apple blossom? Five. You're exactly right. When that comes out, an apple blossom is what we call, it's a mix. It has both vegetative flowers as well as floral flowers, and each bud that comes out here, every flower bud is going to have five flowers. How many of those can we tolerate and live with?
One.
So again, at that point, we need to thin out 80%. Leave the center king bud. We've got four laterals that we need to get rid of those as well.
Then you don't have none left on the squirrel.
That's a different story.
I'm
Yeah. Again, I can't. I wish I had an answer. Some people say that you can use dogs with a, put them out there with an invisible fence. But again, all the squirrels, if they're jumping from other trees into your apple trees, fruit trees, there's nothing you can do about it. Just plant enough trees and.
Yeah,
that's right.
I don't think that works.
I
think you just
run over squirrels.
Could be.
I have a question before going back to one of the photographs you had. All that man that had an orchard that split all those trees.
Yes.
Was that his fault? Did he not thin enough, or is it something in the wood? Was that bad weather that played? Well, what did you suggest to help him correct that after that? And what species or what type of variety was that? Do you remember?
That was Carolina Gold.
Okay.
It's now released. It was a numbered slice at that point in time. And again, if you look at it, a lot of that has to do with how the trees are trained and pruned. Mark, are we still raining out?
We can do it now.
We can go.
Okay. Because we can look at fruit trees. Part of this here is part of the thinning issue. The other thing is it was the trees weren't trained to start with the best way they could have been. So do y'all feel comfortable going out in the field?
Sure.
We can discuss a lot of that there.
Well, again, if we look at a tree like this, it's 1 year old, what are we going to do to it? Do we have an open center tree?
No.
We'll cut it all down.
We want one.
But again, you have to realize when I cut a tree down, it's for a reason now. Again, it's hedging my bets. There's a couple things we can do. One is we could come in and say, okay, this will, again, I've got one branch, don't I?
Mm-hmm.
One branch that gives me, are any of these other branches suitable for scaffold branches?
Mm-hmm.
They're all growing down, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
I need the upward 60 degree angle.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That one. Oh. 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 Oh.
Was that
you? Oh. Actually, I thought you were going to do.
I'm going to. And again, come back, and again, we have to talk about what we're doing, first of all. I have no problem starting young trees. I have no problems coming in and cutting in this area here. However, this one's been painted. We don't have buds there. But look at the buds that I have here. Can you see they're sticking out?
Mm-hmm.
Those buds are ready to go. So again, they're a little, again, I would rather have branches down here. I don't have it. It was on my Christmas list. It didn't happen. So again, I come in, I had it like this. The top three or four buds are going to be very upright. The bottom branches will come out. These top three or four buds are going to come up very upright. Remember I talked about?
Mm-hmm.
So what I'll do is, we can see, this is where it was at. A heading cut was made right there. See that heading cut made right there?
Mm-hmm.
See the heading cut? Look at the top three branches. One, two, three. Those are accidents waiting to happen. But as I move away from that, notice how the crotch angles spread right out.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want to have. So again, these upright branches, when that growth is 8 to 10 inches long, you have to pretend with me, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
I'll come in and grab them when they're 8 to 10 inches long, and I'll snap them off just like this. You can grab them. You just come in and grab them and just snap them over like that. By snapping them off, I leave them there. They don't break off. I leave them there. They look downright ugly. But what we're trying to do is these tips that produce hormones that inhibit lateral branching, I'm getting rid of that influence. So again, the tree's already invested in this growth. In the fall of the year, it's going to take all that food. It's going to send it into the trunk and root system. I'll come in and cut that out during the winter to outward growing branches. So again, 6 to 8 inches long. I'll come in, grab these things, snap them over, allowing these lateral branches to grow out. Then next winter, I'll come in and cut that top out and have my open center.
That don't involve much disease in that.
No, yeah. There's no disease issues you have to be concerned about.
But you leave them like that, you snap them and leave them?
Yep.
That would work with another plant. I mean, is that generalizable?
The physiological principle is, because we know that these tips are producing hormones, what we call auxins. The auxins move by gravity within the plant, and they inhibit lateral branching
right
beneath there. So by coming in and doing that, I get rid of the source, the auxins move by gravity, I get rid of it. Now, we did this at the Central Crops Research Station last summer, and they were on 3-year-old trees, and the superintendent called me and she says, Mike, you need to come over here. I'm killing your trees. I don't know what's going on. And we go out there and look at all these branches are broken off in the middle of a tree. This is what we do. This is what it's called, a trashy center. It looks ugly.
Yeah.
It looks ugly for the first year, but you cut it out, you'll never know the difference. So the principle The principles do apply.
So, you're breaking it off as opposed to cutting it?
Yes, because I'm leaving it. There's still connective tissues.
Right.
The auxins move by gravity. Right. However, the sugars that they're sent, they're moved actively into the root system. You ever see a pecan tree that the limbs break and they're hanging down or they're laying on the ground? As long as they're green, you leave them. Those nuts will mature. Any type of fruit tree will do that. A large tree. So the trees were headed here. Did these summer prune? You didn't cover out the suckers? Okay.
Most of them.
Yeah. Usually we make a heading cut, we get multiple breaks coming. Again, this is going to be a central leader tree. But my first set of branches down here. Four branches. Do I have four? These were clothespinned, weren't they?
Some of them were.
I know I put some. But notice the crotch angles. The crotch angles are good. Do you see four scaffold branches?
Yeah.
We don't need that one, do we? Can we take that one off?
Is anything coming over in that direction?
The above.
Because I guess I've looked at it. I'd look at this one right here. Let me call this one one. Let me call this one two, 90 degrees. Let me call this one number three coming out this way. Where's number four at? What's that?
I would take
this one here or this one here?
This one here.
This one here?
That one. Yeah. This one's easy to work with.
That one's a little, you don't even need this pretty. It's going up. Yeah. And again, you know, the discussions you're making here now, they're all valid. Again, there's no right way to prune a tree, but there are wrong ways. But again, if I start looking at, how about this one here? Is this a good one to use? Why not?
Too mature.
But look at the diameter. Look at the diameter of that branch compared to the diameter of the leader. How close is it?
Pretty close.
Very close. So again, if I look at the diameter between the tip of my thumb, my tip of my finger, is there a difference in diameter between here and here?
No.
No. How about if I go between here and here, from here to here?
Yeah.
I've got a basically a choke point right there.
Uh-huh.
So that one to me is not suitable.
Okay.
So I'll cut that one off.
That's a competing leader, isn't it?
It is a competing leader, that's correct. And again, it's a, notice where a heading cut would make? It's the closest, Mark, I think these were summer pruned.
Okay.
There were buds here that were.
I can't.
They were rubbed off because when we make a heading cut like that, remember you talked about the top three or four buds are very upright. You talk about competing leaders. You're exactly right.
Okay.
So again, I need something over in this direction. There's no right or wrong. I like this one here.
You do.
I did.
Yep.
This younger wood, it stands a chance of maybe bending for you.
So what about we're gonna have to get rid of that one, right?
Do we?
Not really.
Yeah, we do.
Oh, and we get rid of that one.
You see my four scaffold branches?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, again, now where are all the apples going to be formed at? On an apple tree.
The tip.
Again, these trees they're not going to have anything here. But again, when it starts growing, I'm going to have a branch coming out here, multiple branches coming out here, and I'll get branching for about 12 to 18 inches behind that tip. So I've got a lot of fruit back towards the trunk, don't I?
No.
So what we'll do is we'll come back and head these at about 18 inches. Because I know that a heading cut like that will encourage encourage branching for about 18 to 24 inches back.
Okay, so you want to keep it closer to the trunk.
I want branching as close to that trunk as possible. Notice this one here? Is that shading or shaded? Leave it there. Don't head it, invigorate it. So again, that's what we'll do. Now, our leader. How about that? On a central leader tree, what's the next set of growth I want in this?
Closer to the first set.
Yep, I want branches approximately 18 to 24 inches, so I want branches up in this area here. So what I'll do is I'll commit 6 inches above that, cut that out there, get rid of this one here.
Yep.
Now, when the growth starts in the spring of the year, what kind of growth am I gonna get from this cut? You're gonna witch's broom going straight up, right? So come back in when growth is 6 to 8 inches long, select one branch to maintain my leader, then come in and eliminate all competition for a fist width, and then where I've got my clothespins, I want my next set of branches to come. At that same time, knowing that these cuts are going to do the same thing, I will have three or four branches. At that point in time, select one branch to continue out, eliminate competition for a fist whip.
Okay.
That makes sense? I'll do that all the way around the tree. So again, I get rid of the competition, I'm maintaining my scaffold growth, I'm also getting lateral growth back in here. Then when these branches, when I come in and do that, these, you know, I get rid of the top competition, some of these branches may be more upright. That's where I'll come in and I'll put a clothespin over top of that shoot. Those shoots coming out, I'll put a clothespin above it, directing it outward.
So that's more than 24 inches though.
How far is that?
It's more like, it's at least 30.
30.
Okay.
There you go.
You all heard it here. And now again, I'm going to put a disclaimer here. How many of you have ever heard of ambrosia beetles?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, ambrosia beetles, they're beetles that they come in. They're actually off this time of the year. They come in, they burrow into the side of the tree. The ambrosia beetle, they carry a fungus in their mouth parts. So what they do is they come in the tree, they put that fungus there, the fungus grows, feeds their young. So again, they call them ambrosia beetles because they turn wood purple. As a wood turner, I love ambrosia wood, but some tree gave its life to get that. So again, the ambrosia beetles, they key in on weak trees, or for the most part, they key in on the alcohol released by the tree. So when you prune a tree heavily like that, I told Mark, I would spray them with an insecticide in the very near future so that we don't have those ambrosia beetle infections.
What kind of time frame?
Now?
I don't do insects. I'm a horticulturist. This time of the year, again,
as soon as you prune it.
As soon as you, well, if we're pruning this time of the year, yes.